The following video was assembled as visual reference for a seminar given by Kim Davidson on June 18, 1999 at the University of Waterloo. The purpose is solely educational, and all the images and clips used in the video remain the copyright of the respective owners. In the next hour, you are going to see a lot of computer imagery. As you view it, I will try to describe some of the problems and challenges behind the creation of those images. The imagery spans from 1974 to 1999, and has been ordered chronologically so you can see the progression of the art form. In choosing the clips, I tried to choose from projects I was personally involved with or I am familiar with. However, a few clips were chosen because they were landmark achievements or representative of a particular market or technique. I have also tried to make sure that most of the key companies are represented. Finally, I have taken a bit of a Canadian slant, which wasn't hard to do, as many of the key contributors have been companies and computer animations from Canadians. So first we will have some little bit of terminology of the marketplace, because these are mostly entertainment pieces, so we want to define our markets that computer graphics is used in. So computer graphics is used in entertainment markets, broadcast, which is largely TV and news, advertising, film, video games, video TV shows, and location-based entertainment is LBE. Those are rides that you might go on at a theme park or such. Some of the early milestones prior to 1985, Westworld was one of the first movies to use some digital animation. A Future World was one where it was 3D animation in 1976. Waterloo opened up their computer graphics lab in 1980. In 1974, Hunger was one of the first pieces that used morphing. It's digital animation. It's done with NFB money, and it was one of the early uses of computer graphics. Now it's not 3D, but it is all digital, fully digital computer-generated film that tells a story. In 1982, Tron took three companies, Magi, Digital Effects, and Able, to create the imagery for some of the sequences in that movie by Disney. These pieces here were done by the company Magi, and you can see that it's very flat shaded polygons. In order to make the characters blend more with the computer graphics, they put reflective tape on the characters and shot them under lights, so those are live people matted in with computer graphics. This was probably one of the more elaborate sequences in Tron, so you can see what kind of quality, and there's some flashing polygons in there that you can see in the Tron piece. So this goes back to 1982. There were about approximately 40 companies in the whole of computer animation around that time in the world, and it took three of them several months to produce this imagery for Tron. So we start really our history at 1985. SGI shipped its first workstation in 84, but that really wouldn't take effect until about 5 years later. Money for Nothing was the first music video done for Dire Straits, and Last Starfighter was done using the Cray XMP by Digital Productions in 1984. So here's a movie a few years later after Tron using a Cray computer to generate the rocket sequences. Those smoke and fire are all live elements that have been optically composited in, so they're not computer graphics. It's simply the ships. Even the star fields would have been done optically under a camera, and then you would do optical mats of the computer graphics to get on top of the star fields. This is Gary Adelson, the co-producer, talking about the movie. And this is the Digital Production Studio, so you note the monitors, they're all text-based monitors. That's the Cray XMP. It's about a $125 million computer and did about a billion calculations per second. They did about 300 scenes for the movie, or 25 minutes worth of animation for The Last Starfighter. This is John Whitney Demos, who was the president of Digital Productions. And this is Ron Cobb, the production designer. So he was not a computer person, but he designed the sequences and the look and the feel, so he would have a input into how the computer graphics should look and marry with the rest of the design of the movie. So he was the overall movie designer. To input the models that they designed, you use something called a digitizer, and whenever you go over a point, you click down. This is a vector display, very much different from what most people are used to today, is the raster displays. The vector display simply draws and displays lines, so that's a fairly sophisticated display device of the time. So we weren't, you can see there's no raster or color pictures up on any of the terminals. This would be the most visual and interactive that they could get, and it was probably after the sequence was built, and they simply could rotate the models in a wireframe. You said the average frame took about 72 billion calculations. Brilliance was a commercial done in 1984 by Robert Abel, who was a commercials director. And you can see even today, this at least camera cuts, stylistically wise, this holds up. This was done for the Super Bowl, so it would have been a commercial costing somewhere on the order of $100,000 to $150,000 in 1984. But you have ray tracing to get you the nice reflections, which was a very expensive to compute ray tracing imagery. Here's some logos. This is really what paid the bills of around 1985, 1986. The CBC logo of that era. This is a First Choice Super Channel, I believe. And you can notice nice reflections and transparency. But they're all about 5 seconds, and they probably cost in the order of $50,000 to do. So it's a very expensive proposition, maybe 4 or 5 people working on it for the 12 weeks to do a logo of this sort. Not a lot of, no textures, simple lighting, white highlights, lots of chrome and gold were typical of the logos of that era. 1985, there was a music video was another area that used computer animation. This is done with Magi software by a Montreal company, so the so it shows integration of live and computer-generated trees, which were shot on a monitor and then enhanced or glowed by putting a filter on the lens. And I don't have the clip, but Hard Woman by Mick Jagger was done by Digital Productions, and it had a very, very similar look, coincidentally. In 1985, corporate communications was another area. This was very rare, though, and inexpensive. The reflections you see in the floor are not ray-traced reflections, but geometry that were put in with transparency. In 1985, Tony DePeltry aired at SIGGRAPH. It had been 2 years in the making, and it really was one of the very first times where computer animation was able to do figurative animation and to tell a story, to emote, to draw the viewer into the to the sequence and get people to believe that this art form, just as Disney's Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs many, many years before it, could make people believe that it could tell a story. This commercial, done with Magi Synthavision software in 85 for a computer video game called Worm War. What's interesting here is that is the commercial with the 3D geometry right there, and the game itself is, as you can see, fairly crude graphics. And if you compare that with today, you have games that play in real time that are better than the commercial that would have taken 6 to 8 weeks to produce that commercial, and perhaps $80,000-$100,000 to make that commercial for Worm War. So there's quite this is very instructive as far as the leap of technology that has happened in the 10 or 15 years. The next piece is Wild Things. It was done with Magi and Disney. It was a test. That's not a little hiccup. It was a test done by Disney to integrate live, 2D animation, which is the little boy and the dog for Wild Things, and the CG 3D backgrounds. The person who worked on this from Disney was John Lasseter, who went on to Pixar and still remains as one of the key art directors and creators at Pixar Animation. But Disney was not that interested in pushing this technique forward at the time, but it remains as an early example of what could be done by integrating the two mediums. Another thing that computer animation was good for at the time was show openings. They had a significant amount of budget to do these animations. This one's done by a company in UK called Digital forgotten the name Digital Pictures in the UK, and it's all those sets are model sets, so the only CG is the colored characters jumping around. But I think it's a nice use of CG, flat shaded, simple polygons, but very effective. Lots of motion, and lots of they're picked off the background by use of color over the black and white background. So I think this is a very effective use. It probably would have cost $50,000, $60,000 to create that. Magi Synthavision was the Magi software. Created this one. There's a lot of nice ray tracing. The animators who worked on this would not see their images, though, until they were actually recorded to film. So this was a piece that actually got recorded to film, and then if the film got developed, and then you saw how it worked. In 1986, Pixar worked on this piece, and it was quite a landmark piece. This is John Lasseter's first piece after going over to Pixar, and showed a lot of shadows and light and shade. Disney did Navigator in 1986, which was a chrome spaceship that reflected its environment, and then it was put back over the live. These were some of the technical advancements around that time. Textures were really sort of a brand new. Shadows were a rarity. I'll try to pick out some of the advancements in a 1987 omnibus demo reel for you and point them out as we go through this 3 or 4 minute demo reel. There's lots of little clips. There are no textures on this landscape. It's what polygon point color, so you get the variation in the color by simply coloring the different points on the landscape. So you'd have light green and dark green points. So that's all scan line traced. And now this whole sequence here is all vector. This would have been computer animation shot onto a vector monitor and with a camera, and you get color simply by putting different filters and backing up the camera and doing another pass. So the red pass would have been separate from the blue pass and the green pass. So this is all vector. This is a dream sequence early in the movie. So this was a typical use of computer graphics because it couldn't look photoreal. So it often was used for computer interfaces in the movie or a dream sequence such as that. The background there was one of the first uses of bump map at Omnibus. A very subtle bump. It doesn't move. It might actually have some artifacts if it moved. So there's another use of the bump map, but again, very limited use. It probably wasn't very robust, or so it was either expensive or, as I say, artifacts. There's a little bit of a reveal. Those were very tough things to do. This was done by Omnibus in Los Angeles just for a network logo. glows of that sort at the end of that logo were probably put in with a video switcher and not done in computer graphics at all. You'll notice a lot of these pieces, the highlights are white. There's some nice transparency. Even those blurs there were just simple use of geometry that had transparency built into it. Here's this piece. Notice the popping polygons all over the place. So there really was very bad rendering tools. We had to sort a lot of polygons by hand for a piece like that. This was an animated piece that was similar to the opening to Navigators or Explorers, was shot on a monitor that can draw vector lines. So you would put an image up there, it'd be fairly stable, and then you'd click the camera, and then you'd put another image up and click the camera. And the glows were done with a filter in front of the lens, so that's not, you would not see that in the image on the monitor, but after the film was developed, you would have the glow effect. So wherever there's lines close together, you get a brighter glow, or where the line moves in an odd way, so you get that kind of artifact. And it actually works for this piece. A lot of times that would be the case where an artifact would, we'd sell it as a technique, some early morphing that wasn't really that hard, because all the points remained the same, the objects were very similar. An interesting piece of this one was the yellow on the logo. Most of our highlights were white, if we had highlights at all, and this was one of the early pieces that I remember that actually had colored highlights, so you can see the highlights have a yellowish tinge, and it again feels fairly realistic, at least for the time. It was kind of amazing. There's another landscape that's got point colors, not texture map, but point colors. There are about four cars in this commercial. They took about an animator, each animator took one car, and took them about 2 or 3 weeks each to create the car. Now those cars you would load on over the internet. That'd be probably better resolution in about a minute. This was Creation of the Universe, a TV special, and it had point coloring on the little particles that come up, on little points that come up, and that's how you get the yellow into the red on the little hilltops. Watch this one. It looks like there's a morph there, but it's just a quick dissolve done in video, so there's really two sequences put together. This is about most sophisticated particle systems would be something of that nature that you just saw. Another piece from the corporate communication piece. That's real fire, not computer fire, so when you had to do something like that, you would do live, and you'd do it in the video switcher, not anything to do with a computer. This is the last sequence, or a sequence in the, again, the Explorers, the dream sequence. The interesting thing about this sequence is there's little bits of video noise on some of the pieces that pop up, like on the one on the right there. Those were not done in computer graphics because there was no texture mapping when we did this. They were put in with something called an ADO video switcher, video device. So they were done in video, frame by frame, trying to register after the fact the video image to the moving computer graphic image. So that was a demo reel of the time, and there were, so say, there's four or five companies that would have been making demo reels. Now, this is not 3D computer graphics, but I include it. This is Willow, the movie Willow of 1987, I believe it was, and done by Lucasfilm. And it was the first 2D image morph, so that's all digital image morph, but it's not the first, but the first that made it really popular. After this, we saw a lot of morphing in commercials and in music videos. So it really was this effect in this movie that made 2D digital morphing popular. So I focus largely on 3D, but this I found was a landmark 2D that I just felt I should include. Some of the hardware around the time of 1985 were using 1-inch and 2-inch videotape. I'll show some of these. This is called the Scanimate. There's a camera on the upper left that's pointed at a little monitor. There's the close-up of it, and it could actually, you then would take the video, put your image on that little monitor, and then you dial these knobs to mess up the video, give it a glow, give it a warp, and record that. Here's an animator in Omnibus, New York, Rod Paul, who's sitting at text-based terminals working on a show. And here's an Omnibus, New York staff putting in input points similar to the digital productions. This is not anything to do with CG, but these were typically, we spent a lot of time with a video switcher. That's a grass switcher for layering all the video together. There's a 1-inch videotape to put the record. The machines in the front are it's backup storage, disk storage, and the machine in the back is data, is RAM or live storage. That's called the PEL for picture element storage, and it would been at Omnibus. There's another picture of the Cray at Digital Productions with the cover off. So when we move about 5 years later, many of the giants now have closed, probably thanks to the advent of the personal iris by SGI. The video toaster is just coming on the scene from Amiga, but that probably won't have its effect for another 5 years. So you see a lot more shops opening up using smaller turnkey systems. This was a location-based entertainment ride at the base of Mount Fuji in Japan. It was done by Omnibus Japan with some of the work and modeling done in Toronto at Dome Productions, doing some of the creatures. You see the notice already some of the differences between from 5 years ago. There's some particle systems, so more geometry on the scene, more sophisticated light rendering techniques, textures, some atmospherics, some roll off that was necessary, bubbles to make it feel underwater. But again, this the ride is probably only 2.5 minutes. Probably had a very healthy budget, and it could afford. So this had been a high end piece of the 1990s. That well, it was done in 1989. There's no NURBS or curved surfaces. Branch mathematics give you nice smooth surfaces. The creatures would all be probably 20,000-30,000 polygons. This is another one just about a year later, done by DeGraff Warman. It's very similar, location-based entertainment ride. So in second generation kind of company. Nice thing about this, it shows an integration of 2D animation registered in these fast camera shots to 3D. So the tracking would have been, you'd have to print out all the frame by frame all the shots and then have the animators hand roto in their 2D. So they could get tight registration. But there's no motion blur on any of the images that go by. Very expensive to motion blur at that time, computer graphics. But still a lot of, a lot of nice art direction and good use of the quality at the time. This was TV show Odo on Deep Space Nine. It was done with blobs, a new type of, or metaballs, a new type of geometry of the time. You have, it's sort of easier to morph, gives a liquid feel. So that was a TV use, one early TV use of CG. This is a demo reel done in 1989. So it'll show, again, a lot of the changes that have happened over that five-year period from 85 to 90. You have reflections and refraction. See the nice reflections. They're just, that's not ray traced, it's just a reflection map, particles. The other thing is a lot, this is a little corporate communication piece, so those companies that only had a few hundred dollars could get a few seconds, so the cost had come down where they could actually get a little logo animation done for their presentation, corporate presentation. And there's supposed to be computer shots, or our computer shots from the War of the Worlds TV show. Lots of more particles in the imagery of the era because you could handle more. This is actually all 2D. When the client couldn't afford 3D, you would get on a paint box and paint it up to look like 3D, and it was less expensive again, but people were asking for the 3D look, so we could sell. This piece here was all done in the video switcher, so there's no CG at all. It's a part of the demo reel. Here's 100% computer graphics for a herbicide piece from a 30-second commercial that aired in the prairies. Again, show openings were very high and nice reflections. Had a lot of money, still using lots of chrome, all 2D in that one. But here's a couple 3D balls rendered up, but this was all done on a 2D system just to make it look like it was 3D. Very quick, very, very inexpensive. A bit of flashing going on. Usually that was get away flashing by softening some of the reflections. Nice color in the reflections, going from a transparency to a solid object. So now we go 5 years further, and we'll call a second wave. If 90s was the first wave, the video toaster's been around for a while. We now have Doom game, much more more powerful graphics around. I'm going to let the original audio play for this next piece, which is a 3D animation done by PDI for the Simpsons TV show, and is really a parody on computer animation.
Oh, heavenly testament to the eternal majesty of God's creation.
Holy macaroni!
Hey, you can just suck them out.
Hello? Can anybody hear me?
Homer, where are you?
I'm somewhere where I don't know where I am.
Do you see towels? If you see towels, you're probably in the linen closet again.
Just a second. No, it's a place I've never been before.
The shower.
Hey! I don't want to alarm you, Marge, but I seem to be trapped in here.
We better call Ned. He has a ladder.
What's going on here? I'm so bulgy. My stomach sticks way out in front, and my...
Well, as the tree said to the lumberjack, I'm stumped.
It's like he just disappeared into fat air.
Hey, shut up! Unprocessed fish sticks. Man, this place looks expensive. I feel like I'm wasting a fortune just standing here. Better make the most of it. Watch it, Coney! Oops.
Do you see a light, Homer?
Yes?
Move into the light, my son.
No!
Homer, this is your physician, Dr. Julius Hibbert. Can you tell us what it's like in there?
It's like, did anyone see the movie Tron?
No.
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 Yes. I mean, no. No.
Well, where's my dad?
Well, it should be obvious to even the most dim-witted individual who holds an advanced degree in hyperbolic topology that Homer Simpson has stumbled into the third dimension.
Sorry.
Here is an ordinary square.
Whoa, whoa, slow down, Egghead.
But suppose we extend the square beyond the two dimensions of our universe along the hypothetical Z-axis there. This forms a three-dimensional object known as a cube or a frincahedron in honor of its discoverer. Hey.
Help me! Are you helping me or are you going on and on?
Oh, right, and of course within we find the doomed individual. Enough of your borax, Poindexter. Man's life is at stake. We need action. Take that, you lousy dimension!
Oh, There's so much I don't know about astrophysics. I wish I read that book by that wheelchair guy.
So that was a little piece which showed a nice also integration here of 3D animation over live, so getting the reflection in the mirror and the right lighting look so that it blends seamlessly. In 1995 was the first all-feature animation done by Pixar, which is Toy Story. Very bad dub, but of course you'd have to put this as any in any inclusion of history. In 1996, Hercules movie by Disney had the Hydra, and that which is that hand there and this head, and it's all done in 3D, but they go to great lengths to make it look very 2D. Again, just to show you some of the integration, but a lot of flexibility, a lot of stretch and squash on that 3D animation, very smooth surfaces. So always looking at a demo reel of the era gives you one of the better flavors of what kind of things are possible. So we think back to the 5 years ago, what we're seeing, and now what we're seeing, lots of different types of surfaces. I think the main thing you see is lots more particle systems, more integration of live, more photoreal, better looking. For instance, in Apollo 13, there was no NASA footage at all. All the effects in Apollo 13, the smoke, the fire, the stars, all that were done with computer-generated imagery. Much better lighting techniques. You see it in many different markets now too. These are games. These are sequences of games that of the time. So nice texture map, nice lighting. They're all computer graphic ignition on the Apollo 13 takeoff. Some very organic type of objects like trees. This was another game of the time. So character animation, starting to see some more character animation even in a game, not just in Toy Story, if you like, but in those things that wouldn't have as big a budgets are now affordable to have characters. Lots and lots of integration again with live, with the film effects and commercials of the time. This was a promo for a TV show, a pilot that never got produced. But so even tests are more elaborate tests for TV shows, things that people never saw, but ended up being done very high quality. Even a cable station has a very attractive computer graphics opening. Some of these companies are around the world. Some are from Japan, Hollywood, UK. It's a commercial from Japan. Very nice reflections. Ray tracing now is probably used more than scanline renders. Ray tracers allow for nice things like refraction and reflections. This is the piece from the pilot for the TV show that was never produced. More organic imagery, smoke, fire, better integration with live. A commercial that might only run for 2 or 3 weeks now have a computer-generated imagery in it. The other thing that's is happening in the computer graphics world is it's not all 3D. There's a lot more 2D, digital 2D. 3D by its very nature was always digital. Maybe going to an analog or a rendering, but now there's 2D systems that create a lot of these effects that sort of look 3D. This is a Power Rangers, where this was using blobs again to do the morphing. Obviously lots and lots of polygons, This is taking in the 2D image and doing a puff on it and putting it over a 3D image. So you're making the 2D animation look like 3D as opposed to making the 3D look like 2D. So people are experimenting with new styles, new looks. Lots more artists have access to the tools. So that's why you get a lot of these. Before it was a lot of the technical people. Now it's a lot more artistic people have easier tools to work with. So you'll notice a lot more artistic approaches and different looks being in all the footage. For coin-operated game, there'd be sequences that then would be triggered by the participants' actions. Today, what are we moving ahead almost 5 years later? We have really just a lot of powerful, inexpensive computers. And what that buys you is one of three dimensions. You can either do graphics in real time, or you can do very, very photoreal, which would be computationally heavy, or you can do just lots of footage. Jerry's game is another little sample from Pixar, who won an Academy Award for animated short couple years ago, and the main thing that they were testing, they're always testing a new technique with their shorts, and the main thing they were testing in this short was their cloth. So this was one of their first tests to check out the cloth render. It's a little bit of popping on the cloth, but again, with great direction, your eye is not really focused on the cloth. It's there to support the piece, not to draw your eye to it. It's sort of supposed to be seamlessly integrated. They do very nice things too in their camera direction. When they cut to the nice guy, you see the yellow trees. When they cut to the sort of the evil chess player, he's got red trees behind him. So this, we cut into the about a 3 minute piece about halfway, so this is really just the climax of the little sequence. Nice depth of field, very soft shadows. Next thing we're going to look at is a demo reel from this era, so almost five years later. You see, again, now we can actually see sometimes the amount of quantity. We see sometimes more geometry or better lighting, but really some of the advances are unseen. Just the sheer number of companies that are able to produce footage of this quality and the amount of footage of this quality. There's all the water in DreamWorks. Prince of Egypt was done in 3D, but rendered to look very 2D again to blend in. But where it used to be a simple little character, now it's very complex effects shots. Or long 2.5 minute opening of all CG, as in this piece from Contact. So tons of volume, lots of volume. And these some of the animators that worked doing testimonials that worked on the pieces. A piece from Japan, lots of smoke, 3D IMAX, even the amount of rendering time now taken for a large IMAX film where you're rendering 3,000 pixels across as opposed to TV where you only need 640 pixels across. So you're able to do that. Before, you would have not had the computer, the storage, or it would have been prohibitively expensive to do it. Time certainly would have been a factor, and time is one of the big costs, obviously. Commercials you've probably seen on TV. Sometimes you don't even know that there's computer graphics in it. They use computer graphics to as an inexpensive approach now to something that done optically or done with real pyrotechnics or with real people might be expensive, but done with computer graphics, it might actually save money. And for instance, this piece in Fly Away Home with the flying Canada geese was done to get the geese to behave where they couldn't get the real geese flying in quite the same formation. But the producers never really wanted to talk about the computer graphics. They don't want to take away from the movie by talking about the computer graphics. So most uses of computer graphics in the commercials and on TV shows are invisible uses, and you're not even aware of them. Lots of particles, bubbles, fluid animation, nice reflections, seamless. Be a lot of geometry in the cracking of the X-Files movie there, so a lot of texture map layers, a lot of particles. And there again, another stylized look for logos. Just the amount of geometry and different looks, I think, is really what typifies this current time frame. Not a lot of photoreal characters, that's to come, but definitely almost everything. But this was a game, so before we saw kind of the blobs or the metaball characters, creatures in a feature film, a few sequences, now you can have for a lower price, you can get the same kind of look in a game. And in the Titanic, for instance, the water's all computer generated, the wake is computer generated, the people on the deck of the boat, the smoke, there's some birds flying around, the smokestacks as well. In the distance, you can see getting all the roll off. So there's probably, you know, a dozen layers, digital layers, computer layers that put together to make just that one beauty shot. A lot of talking animals are sort of typical too of this era, where you register the 3D geometry to the live animation, and then you actually put then texture maps of the fur onto the CG geometry, onto the geometry that's 3D, and put it back over top of the live. So it has to be registered and has to match the look and the feel. Talking about using particle systems to do particles, pieces of the building being bowed out and particles coming off in the movie Godzilla. It's all live coming off the computer for a game. Very complex 3D made to look like 2D again in the Prince of Egypt film. Very much a 2D paintings that have come in and been mapped onto geometry and then pushed a little bit with a camera to make a sort of a what I call a 2.5D look with many of these images, where you sort of play with the 2D and the 3D and the live and have come up with a lot new experimentation, not new looks, and just the speed with which you're able to get imagery in and out and acquire images is very much a part of what you're able to do in attaining these new looks that you could not do before. Again, looking in the water, all computer graphics, all computer generated, lots and lots of particles. So what's for the future? I always look at some of the research that's been done for the time. There's no particular order or rationale behind the pieces I've chosen here, but SIGGRAPH is a big computer graphics conference held each year for people who are interested in computer graphics, and a lot of the new paper and new works are published and put onto video. So I've just grabbed a couple pieces to show you some of the things that people are working on, like adaptive subdivision of meshes, and this would be things that might end up in commercial packages later that would happen without the user knowing. But these are some of the math, the achievements that have to be technical achievements and have to be solved, and problems that have to be solved to get better interfaces. Here's just better display devices for viewing 3D images and objects. So when you put the card in a way, you can see the trick. But when you know everything about the surfaces in the room, you can view it views as total 3D. Again, here it's more of a projection system. So computer graphics, not all just restricted to Hollywood films, but a lot of research going on in many different areas of rendering and modeling. Most of the lighting was early lighting was scan line, and then there was ray traced, and then something called radiosity. This is a new technique in lighting and rendering, where you take environment maps to get an even more realistic lighting, or at least different, if not more realistic. It's better in some ways. There's some research that was done on being able to take a model and scanning it in from just two viewpoints, and then at a later date recreating. So there's two scans recreating the model from simply from two images, but knowing the viewpoints and the positions that it was taken at, you are able to recreate the model backwards from the two images. Another big problem in computer graphics is getting realistic walking. So if you have a walk cycle but change the size of your character, you get something like this, some popping. But good algorithms will do some sort of interpolation to fit the new shape and size character to the new to the walk cycle, so it goes smooth on the ground. Here's taking scanned images of a real face and then creating the geometry. Again, these aren't commercial packages, but give you a feeling of some of the work that's being done in the different areas. Taking the expressions, and then through a sliders, combining the expressions to make new expressions, combinations. This is a music video. If we remember the early music videos, very flat shaded, maybe not even the whole music video, intercut with a live artist or something. This was a 3.5 minute video that was done in 6 weeks. It's about 9,000 frames needed. There were 70 multi-layered shots in the video, all computer graphic landscapes, effects, smoke, fire, and obviously you have to integrate the live into the, in kind of a complex way to match all the camera motion. So again, this just shows a music video typically doesn't have a lot of money. This shows what can be achieved. So the sheer volume of footage that you're able to put out now is sometimes, again, more inexpensive than actually obviously trying to go out and shoot that with planes over the desert, if you could find such a landscape in the first place. So that's kind of an example of quantity of animation, reasonable quality, but certainly a lot of quantity done in a short time. Here's an example of just outputting computer animation in real time. You could, control characters or games, obviously, but here's some impressionistic imagery being controlled by dancers in a nightclub, where they can interact with input devices to change the color or the shape or the scale. So this is coming off in real time to the monitors in the dance club. So you can have a lot of footage. You can have more footage, real-time footage, coming off real-time. Or the last dimension of the time, as I say, with all the power, is you can have very photoreal and going photoreal on humans, which is probably the sort of last challenge, was not too far off, but these would not be generated real time, but they would certainly, they're certainly close to being photoreal, but the human is a very tough problem to get real, but this is fairly close, but you have to worry about the skin is in a complex lighting model, hair is certainly a complex dynamics to the hair, both in the lighting and in the motion. Any muscle and fat, that sort of thing is very hard. Cloth, certainly, but it gives you a good feeling for how close. This is a TV series that I close with that I'm working on, which is 26 half hours, or I have a company, Catapult, working on 26 half hours being produced. Each half hour is really 22 minutes of character, all computer graphics, imagery. So Saturday morning TV, again, doesn't have a lot of dollars per footage, but this is certainly being, this is being produced for industry, you know, rates, the standard that they would get for 2D animation. So we will see in the future more and more 3D animation along with the other 2D and live children's shows. You'll see more Saturday morning 3D animation. Nice thing about keeping it all computer animation, shadows, the effects, the camera, all live in the same world. We would keep all the elements separate, but keep the, it's obviously the same camera, so by keeping the elements separate, then if you want to make a lighting change or darken a shadow or something of that nature, you could do it in the composite, but it's always registered. So you can get a lot of play with the medium. Don't overuse the medium, but it's going to allow for a lot more new looks that are not 2D and not live. And I think that's the beauty of any new medium that comes into a creator's hand, is it allows for some new experimentation. Computer graphics really does lend itself nicely to TV animation because computers are good at doing things over and over and over again. So when you set up systems, set up controls for the character, set up lighting models, set up input and output systems, then the computer is very good at repetitive tasks, and there's a lot of repetitive tasks in doing 26 half-hour TV animation. So I'll close with that. Really, it's a to be continued, because the history of computer animation and entertainment, or any other industry for that matter, is not really done. There's still a lot of work, a lot of companies contributing, and that ends my talk. Thank you very much.